And after many starts in regard to that, I think it's becoming self-evident that we're getting some great staff in the district, all the way from the superintendent down through our site administrators, to include Ty Devoe at the high school. And I think with their collaboration with the administrative staff that Brent Woodard, the superintendent, has brought together, with the construction staff that he's brought together, he's been able to fulfill the vision of the board in terms of not only getting this high school built, but in developing the academic program for the entire school district. So every time I come and we tour the school, the construction site, and I see progress, it just helps to reinforce that we've turned a corner with this administrative staff that's headed by Dr. Woodard.
Well, and bittersweet that your son is off there in Boston. Yes. At the university and won't get a chance, but your daughter, I think, might.
Yes, my daughter is finishing her junior year, and she will, our goal is to get the classroom portion of this campus opened in September 2015 at the start of the school year, which means my daughter would be able to experience in her senior year at least a partial new campus. Now, she won't be able to get the full experience of the campus, since it will still be under construction for a couple years, but she'll still be able to get into some of these new classrooms and take advantage of the new technology.
Sure, sure. Well, having done some building myself, I know that when you're about two-thirds through the project, you think something like, was I reasonable to ever get into this? But the the finish line is not too far away, so it's going to be a great time, not only for the community, but for all the kids for the next 100 years that'll go through here.
Yeah, we're hoping that our, and I'm fairly confident that the planning that we did for future planning to expand the school when it's necessary, you know, we're still looking at entering into another joint use, hopefully program with the county to bring some additional amenities to this school and have the community enjoy this campus just like the students do. So we fully expect it's going to be a community center point. And
you mean for adult education, things like that?
Ranging from adult education to adult sports activities.
Oh,
to taking advantage of our staging and our all the amenities that we can bring forward. From outdoor activities and sports-related stuff.
Sure.
To performing arts and that sort of thing. So a small community that doesn't have a lot of infrastructure, I think it's important that our schools help to serve a dual purpose.
Sure.
And that's our intent with this school.
Well, on behalf of the community, thank you for spearheading and being at the point of the arrow. And it'll be a great tribute the day the kids walk in to the classrooms.
Thank you, John.
You're welcome.
So you feel free to ask any questions. I'll also have Ty Devoe, he's the principal here, and then Robert Rocha, he's our DSA approved, if you will, inspector for this project. So he'll be along with us as well. We're going to talk a lot about program, et cetera, but it's Socratic today. If you have questions, stop me. I'm not going to speak at you. I want to talk to you, and if you have questions, fantastic. You'd love to be able to answer those. If you don't, you just want to turn around, great. Sounds good too. So it's kind of freewheeling today. So if you can, obviously, you understand it's a full construction, and these guys are blowing and going. We want to make that opening date, so that's why, you know, I appreciate you helping me put on some of the safety gear. It's for a reason. You'll see there's a lot of activity, a lot of pitfalls. So if you will, you just kind of stay together and, you know, keep your eyes open. A lot of stuff going on down there. So if you can, we're ready to go. Let's go.
Can I ask a quick question before we
start? Yes, ma'am.
What's going to happen to this campus and these buildings?
Demolished as fast as I can.
97, 98.
The first graduating class, I think, was 2000. Is that the age?
Yeah, it's been, that might be about right.
Another baseball or
softball, a girl softball.
No, That's 20 years. Because that's how.
But we are looking at a joint use agreement with LA County. But LA County, we're trying to get a joint use agreement with LA County, so we need to do all of the programs in the town.
Well, this is originally we had one figure a year later that was passed. So it was certainly before 2000.
So then what we did is we applied for matching funding from the state.
It's interesting.
The initial 14 and a half. So we have eligibility in terms of construction funding. So this project was funded in part by that. They have to be matched. There's this whole match, and that's why we have to pass the bond. And the state's always had this in-kind match program. And so, depending upon the percentages and your eligibility and all these complex equations, we're eligible for approximately $14.5 million. That's what we've received. It's now in the bank. So none of it's hypothetical. Everything I'm going to tell you today is actual. So everything that's actually happening, and we'll see. It's going as fast as we possibly can. Our opening for phase one, which will be classrooms, will be in the fall in September of 15 this year. So we hope to obviously occupy in the next couple months. That's correct. And we'll not only have full capacity, we'll have excess, meaning that we can house what we currently have and then some. And then we have plenty of expandability. We've designed the whole campus to expand up to over 1,000 kids at ED in the future. Current population is just over 400, 425, somewhere in that neighborhood, and it fluctuates day to day.
Well, you know, these are built in a factory.
Oh, I don't know if it's actually
like this. Very, very, if we can get to a couple of them, I don't know, they're probably buttoned up a lot of them.
So, if you will, this is where the gymnasium is going to be. You can see they're starting to build and the footings and the construction. Everything's already, all the undergrounding's already in. Everything's done. You'll see the fire hydrants. We've done all the undergroundings, all the electrical, all the plumbing, all the sprinkler systems, et cetera, are already built in. So now, obviously, the phase one is going to be our classroom construction. We'll take a view of some of that. We'll probably, Robert, meanders around the turn over at the administration building is right there. And that will also be the library and teachers' facility, nurses, school psychologists, et cetera, will be in that main building. And then obviously the gymnasium will be right here. We'll have a teacher's parking lot here. There'll be another big parking lot where that big mound is. The huge mound over there where that truck is, and then our famous retention basin will be out in the front there. That's all, this property has some of those challenges where that's a floodplain. So we had to account for that floodplain through the retention basin, and it worked out really well. Had some hiccups at the beginning, but now it's all in place, and we can take a tour around there and take a look at that. It's not real that interesting, but I just thought, when you drive by, if you look at it, you know what it is. Yes, Julie.
I thought that's mildly.
It's mildly. Yeah. We expect this to be completed by the fall of 2016. Okay, so it'll be another year from now. And this is full, this is not modular. This is stick built, all brick and mortar, all CMA or CMS bricks, CMUs. And so all of these, it's going to be, I mean, it's a full CIF gym. Full capacity is going to be, you know, at the entire school. We can put in full bleachers. We have locker rooms, weight rooms, team rooms. We're going to have a full culinary, if you will, for the kids. And I'll show you that room. But then also this facility will be a full kitchen. It'll be, you know, a cafeteria where the kids can eat indoors, etc. for the first time, by the way. Yes. And so obviously this is going to be a fantastic building. So, but it's going to be massive, and meaning it's a full facility. It's not some rinky dink. It's fantastic. So I wish I could show you more of it.
It's not a fair payback.
Yes, ma'am.
Just assuming we have any water left in this state.
Well, that's Brett,
We're in the process now of taking that particular building through DSA, and it's almost done. But there'll be another building just like that. Temporary.
And then what happens to that building once?
Well, it still stays there, and it becomes fire space. It was what they call a multi-purpose.
Okay. That was great. Meetings.
It's not going to be full on grass and you know all of that kind of stuff. It's going to be very low water yield. We have a whole septic system. I honestly think I could treat the waste for the entire Acton. It's huge. And it's all environmentally sound. We do testing and making sure the groundwater stays safe. No nitrates and things in the ground.
This will be where all the parking lot is out there. All the student ingress will be from this direction. We have tons of handicap parking and different parking out there. And then this will be the quad. Meaning what I call the quad is the big congregation area, and where you have the meeting area out after a basketball game or volleyball game will be right in this area. So it's a really large area with a stage, an outdoor stage, what we have, and I'll show you that in just a second. But this again is the administration building, has the library and all the stuff, and we'll be walking through this building right now.
Okay. This was our attempt to try and bring a facade.
We have nurses stationed over here for the kids as they come in that door. And then obviously all the parents and anybody that needs to check in will come in through that door. So we have full security system, full security cameras, et cetera, et cetera.
Sure. So the kids don't have to come through the office to the campus, there'll be an outside gate coach.
Well, there is an outside gate, but it's only in the morning. As soon as school starts, then we lock those gates, and everyone has to come through here, kids included, and sign in and make sure we know that you're obviously belong here. So, and kids checking out will come through here, we'll have some furniture and a receptionist here. Then the principal's office is in the back, principal secretary, and everybody will be in this pool right here.
What's this for here?
I'm not sure, I don't know. Big old Yes, well we do, but it's for the district.
But
she'll have for the first time an office. Yeah, she's gonna have her own office and own place, and she'll be housed up here. But she does serve, just to be honest with you, probably more the elementary than anyone, to be honest with you. Those little kids seem to get hurt, scrapes and sick and all that kind of stuff. Probably more so than our high school kids. So, but she'll be housed up here as well, and that's her office. So, we can walk through again if you want to walk through. This is the principal's office, and then this will lead into the hallway where we have all of our other offices. This is the administration building, but it's also, you'll see in the back, we also house the library here. Teachers' workroom, stations, all those kinds of things are also in
Yes,
that's a counselor. We'll be in there. We'll have career counselors in there. Pretty much everything you can think of in a full comprehensive high school. To include librarian, we have custodial offices. Absolutely.
You're absolutely right. Yep. So that's what a lot of buyers are asking. Yep. What capacity is this high school?
It'll be 100% in September. It isn't now, but we're hiring. We're putting it together. We have the money. Everything's there. The funding's there.
That's a huge thing.
Everything's there.
So now you're moving.
Yeah. I
have
four kids
go
home.
Have you?
Yeah, now my kids are done. Now we're going to go to high school.
I know, sorry. Can't help that.
That's awesome.
Yeah, they're throughout the entire project. The solar tubes are throughout the entire project.
It's huge right there. Yeah, it's way bigger than it looks.
Yeah. These are just counselor's offices, vice principal offices, school psychologists, and they go around the U shape. There's offices on the back side, and then teachers' workrooms in the back. That's the library.
Way bigger.
We're going to have one of the things why you'll see such a large facility in the back.
The library's going to be.
We wanted to make obviously a resource center. It's more than just a library. It's going to be a resource center for kids, meaning we're going to have a ton of technology in that particular facility. Our goal is a one-to-one initiative, meaning every kid will have an iPad or a device of some kind, Chromebook, whatever that might, you know, I'm not using Apple necessarily, but a device to be able to connect into our network, tons of resources, you know, and limited amount of books, honestly. All of our books and everything will be on that device through our servers. So we're
all
trying to get
all
the curriculum, all the textbooks, things like that. You won't have to carry your textbook around. That's our goal, is to try to make sure that, you know, we're even looking at, you know, kids will come in and they take attendance or roll by scanning their Chromebook. There's a device, you scan it, and that just documents and tells me I'm there. Basically, the reason why, it's not just it's for fun and technology. It's because we want to go what we're going to call bell-to-bell, wall-to-wall teaching. I don't want teachers taking 15 minutes to take roll. We want to teach the entire hour. So that's part of our goal, is to help teachers do that. There's a lot of devices, Ty, and you can talk real quickly about the technology piece of it. That will help teachers as well, the mics and the...
Yeah. Well, this is to add on and give a tail end to the initiative for the library. We're actually hiring not just a librarian, but a librarian media specialist. It's common in the evolution of librarians these days to become technologically proficient. All of our research, we have multiple digital resources that for research that we're procuring, that the librarian will administer. In the library, we'll be doing professional development both in the library and pushing out to classrooms to teach kids how to research. So we'll have not just book resources, but an extensive amount of digital research resources for kids. On top of that, we're looking at staffing the library both before and after school, 7 to 3:30. So you've got 45 minutes each way, plus brunch and lunch, so kids can come in and do work before school or after school.
And we have a joint use with the LA County Library, the beautiful library that we have here. All of the resources that they have will be accessible to every one of our kids. So we're going to have, you know, their immense amount of resources coupled with ours is going to be, I mean, undeniable. It'll be college level when we get to full capacity.
In classrooms, every classroom equipped with interactive projectors, similar to smart boards or the Epson interactives that have been around for quite a while, as well as document cameras that tie into it, as well as media players. All of these are linked together. The teacher just uses a laptop to control the inputs, and we have assisted listening. So in every classroom you have speakers in the ceiling, and the teacher can either wear a dongle around the neck and control the volume to help everyone hear, or switch the input to stream the audio from the media or whatever other resources they have. And all of that stock in every classroom.
All the networking will be wired throughout all
complete. These. Complete,
correct.
So there will be a crash when everybody's on it.
We have both wired and wireless in every space. Okay. So we have plenty of AP repeaters, including outdoor, so that students can use the Chromebooks outdoor in the quad and access the internet and do work. So we have that as well. But we also have it wired, just in case we have an issue with the wireless.
You never know.
Still happens.
Right.
Okay. So we have backup systems,
for both.
Right.
Okay.
So those kids take those books home every night, the Chromebook?
We're looking at a solution that may allow that, okay, and my concern is, I can hear your concern as well, we may issue books and have them take those home and then utilize that, but I'd love to get to the point where I can let them take them home every day, and the reason being is, it's a resource to them, and I want them to be able to have that. You've probably heard about LAUSD recently and some of the snafus they've had.
Yep.
We're obviously trying to avoid that, and we don't want to, you know, step in a big pit in that situation. We want to make it productive. Unfortunately, I'm going to tell you, you know, kids, they'll hack into it and they'll do some things that, and it could be costly. But we're also looking at very, what can I say, bulletproof, if you will, devices. Number one. And then number two, then we have to infuse some accountability into our kids, making sure they understand this is a privilege. It's not a right to have that. It's a privilege to have these types of technological devices that's funded by the community. They got to understand that. You guys are if you live here, you've funded it. Mm-hmm. We want to respect that. We want to make sure that we're not wasting money unnecessarily. But at the same time, it's going to happen. Kids are kids.
Okay?
Yeah. And so we don't want to let them use our resources because we're trying to protect it so much. But there's a balance, and we got to find that balance. We'd like to get there.
Would it be a networking that can be accessed through their home computer? I mean,
yes, absolutely.
Yes, we're looking strongly at Google Classroom and using Google Drive, which helps teachers and students. Every student have a Gmail account, and they'll be able to upload documents to a specific class Google Drive.
So the tablets can stay there, they can get onto the network and
they
be able
go
to...
Home, they can go home, they can go to Africa, they can go wherever they want to go, and they have the internet to be able to access any document through that, and then obviously they'll have a huge resource center if they want to come in. It's going to be more like a Starbucks feel, if you will, and I use that. It's a very casual, very embraced environment. We want kids to use this. Come in and study, sit around, socialize, maybe, obviously under supervision, okay? But at the same time, we want to invite them in. We want to make it warm and inviting, not a bunch of cold, hard chairs. So there's a vision, if you will, for that. And it's all about exposure. They're going to have access 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, to everything we have. So we're trying to build in safeguards and a net that will obviously protect that.
Do the individual devices come from grant money or hardship money?
And when you say hardship money, John, I mean, that's a whole different word.
Right.
Meaning that we're going to put it out of FF&E, which is furniture, fixtures, and equipment,
okay,
through the entire budget. So it could... You have to look at it in two pots. We have one pot that comes from the bond money, and that was $13 million. And then we have another pot that comes from the state, and that's the $14.5 million. It now is in one pot.
Okay.
It's part of the budget in our FF&E project. So that will, there's a budget associated with it. The board makes approvals on all of those purchases. We're this close to putting that package together, obviously. It needs to happen soon. We're talking desks and chairs and furniture and on and on and on. We'll all be purchased, and it all comes out of the same fund now.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't want to split hairs with you, but that's ultimately how it's funded.
No, I'm just using a colloquialism that we've used over the years about hardship money for Acton to keep up with Beverly Hills.
And in this case, there isn't any hardship money in this project,
okay,
simply because it's out of the bond money and then the state match. And now, again, money's in the bank. It's not hypothetical. It's not wish money. It's there, and it's all going to be funded, and this is full-on project.
Mm-hmm. What's the energy of the kids right now, the students?
Fantastic.
Here?
You tell me.
Is it?
I took the teachers last week on the same tour. Some of them were crying. Just beyond happy. And then, of course, that bled right into the classrooms the next day. And so toward the tail end of last week, there were just a lot of students coming to me out, talking to me about it. They were talking about it. And you know, it's obviously the seniors play it, you know, figures, right, when I'm leaving, you know. So there's
those
jokes.
There'll always be a senior that does that.
There's always
many of you as well, so, you know.
Right. And there's plenty of people that lament the time it took.
We're also incorporating and using, we're going to do different tours with the middle school kids and the elementary kids as well. We want them to get excited about, you know, we can't wait to get the Vasquez. Honestly, you know, without any kind of smoke screen, I'm telling you, that's why you're here too. I want you to ask questions. I want you to understand, especially from the realtor group, you guys are critical to our success. The first people that has any exposure to this community is going to be through you. Well, the first thing I do is I come and find a realtor, I want to buy a house, and I start asking questions about the schools. We don't want you to say, well, I don't know, you're going to have to find that out on your own. We want you to say, well, you know what? Let me tell you about it. It used to be, or whatever story you want to tell, but the other day we took a tour, and here's what it is today. And here's some pamphlets and documents and things that I can prove, and we have the test scores to prove it. We're on this incline, okay? And I mean, are we there yet? No. And I don't think we ever will be because of our standards and the board standards of where we need to be. But I'll tell you, if you've been in this district long enough, you'll know we're nowhere near where we were just 5 years ago. So obviously we want to celebrate that with you, but again, if you have questions or at any time, you have my card in there, you have concerns, feel free to give me a call and I'll be happy to answer those. We'd like to do this on a yearly basis. And like I said, if I have to buy breakfast to get you guys there, dinner, whatever it takes, I want to talk about our schools and I want to celebrate our success on a yearly basis. So thank you for that. And then if you want, we can now walk back and we'll go back through the library and we'll start with that facility. Maybe we can talk a little bit more about that.
And then we'll go back through the
resource center. So you can see the library is in that particular area. It'll all be one area. We're going to have very high-tech systems here. We're teachers, and this will be a false wall. You can see it goes into a pocket, and we can separate this off as another classroom if we need it. And teachers can come in here, and there's a full media center in here where teachers can utilize whatever. We can have different career days, counselor sessions, whatever we need in this particular area here. And then the library itself, you can see, I mean, is sizable for this school. Is it, you know, obviously university level in terms of size and scope? No, but I can tell you that resource-wise, yes, it is. It'll be on the same level as far as content of what's accessible through this venue. We have those areas in the back are going to be used to house computers and whatever that device may be. We have full-on security systems here. Obviously, my big concern is with that much technology on campus, I want to have all of you print full security systems. You know, we have everything we can possibly think of to include motion detectors and video cameras, etc., to make sure we protect and honor that purchase. That's a huge purchase for us. So we want to protect it and make sure it's there and available for all kids. So you can feel free to walk around. It's just a big room, and then they have a librarian access room up here. But you can see it's just going to be a major resource for our kids.
I'll add on that note, we just did camera places. We have almost 40 security cameras covering the campus, just to add to what Dr. Woodard had said. And then if you look on the ground, you'll see a lot of areas of concrete that seem disturbed. Those are actually network and power drops, and those are scattered all throughout. Not all of them are uncovered, but all throughout the library you have direct wire as well as AP repeaters for internet wireless. Same thing we talked about in the other room. So in addition to all the resources you mentioned, it is a place where you can come, sit down just about anywhere and work, which was our goal, indoor or outdoor.
Teachers deal with cell phones in classes now. What do you do with those things?
I think it was a little bit more challenging before there were enough applications and uses for the phones where they could be used instructionally. It's actually grown to the point where, you know, obviously we discourage the use and we have policies to, and when we do, we work with the teachers to enforce that. And it is a challenge. It is a challenge. But more and more of our teachers are beginning to use them as, for example, live surveys. You know, they log into an app, they have questions, and you have instant results. So more and more you see applications that are accessible at school that teachers can use and weave into the curriculum to use it in a positive way rather than a distraction.
But it's, you know, it's never easy.
It's always
hard.
A challenge.
Right.
Yeah.
Obviously tests and things like that, you know, we don't want to make sure, you know.
Notes on our shoes.
I know.
We have internal policies.
Sure,
Well, what we can do, if you will walk back through this way, we'll head out into the quad and we'll visit a few classrooms.
Replace
the teachers that maybe are not as technical.
Well, yeah, we have certain expectations that we already discussed at length about what we expect to be happening in the classroom as a result of what we're providing.
Because this is extraordinary, but everybody has to step up.
Well, it's going to be a, you know, there's going to be a growth.
Right.
And it's a stretch for some, I'm not going to lie. Some teachers are going to have to, you know, understand that this is the new 21st century expectations. And you're going to have to figure out how to manage that. We've got a rigorous professional development program. We're basically saying no excuses. Everyone is going to subscribe to that, and that's part of the expectation, period.
And implement it into the curriculum.
Absolutely, yes, ma'am. Robert, if you would, I'd like to have you talk a little bit about the construction, simply because some of you have asked about it. I think you see some exposed things up here, and if you will, just talk about the general construction versus a stick build and the difference.
So basically, on a stick build project, you would have these 2x6 wood members, and of course they go all the way down to the slab, they're bolted to the slab, and then they extend to the roof. On these modulars, what they do is they have a 6x6, you can see portions of it. They're 6x6 tube steel, along with I-beams along the tops, and they're frames, basically picture frames of 6x6 tube steel, and they frame inside of those tube steel elements and then deliver the buildings. These buildings are very, very stout. And then of course they're set up into 12-foot sections, they're welded. You'll see all these areas that are open. You'll see the welding throughout the, wherever the engineer deemed it was necessary to weld. And then they're insulated and drywalled, and but they're very stout building.
So does that eliminate shear paneling, like you would on a regular?
No, they still have shear paneling.
They still have it.
Yes. So they come in 12-foot sections, and that 12-foot section has shear paneling on it. Of course, plastered. They're plastered and everything at the plant. And then they're delivered out. You'll see all these holes. I was explaining to somebody earlier that all these holes you'll see in the bottom bases in there because the buildings come out bolted with I-beams for transport. And they're bolted up, and then when they deliver them, they unbolt them so that they're not moving around on the trucks.
I have Bob Oleski. I don't know if some of you may know who he is, and Kim Oleski. And Bob is our bond oversight committee chair. And as you know, he's part of the Carpenters Union, and he's been in that and for many, many years. And it was actually instrumental in helping us gain funding through his contacts in Sacramento. He went on a big trip with me to Bakersfield, and obviously we spent all day, a couple days, Robert and different DSA inspectors, and went through the JTS plant in terms of the construction of these facilities, and he was blown away by how well built they are compared to the traditional stick-built construction. You know, you can hear about it. I mean, this is kind of, if you will, the wave of the future. We were very happy, honestly. We originally talked about stick-built. We wanted to kind of go there, but we ended up being forced into a situation where we ended up with this construction. I don't feel, Bob doesn't feel, some of the experts don't feel, in any way, shape, or form did we compromise. And in fact, I think we got a better facility than, and it's the same actual architectural design. Nothing's changed from stick-built. The difference is the methodology. And in this case, you can hear and talk to Bob. You know, I'm not gonna speak for him, and he'll tell you, this is phenomenal in terms of his feeling about the quality of construction that we've elected. And at a much reduced cost, obviously got us in bucket where we could afford all of this. And what we wanted to do is also make sure not only the budget is sound, now we can put it in the sections. And then,
so they end up, you know, and they end up putting back in the T-bar. You'll see some of the fire lines aren't done yet, where they split the buildings. But this was literally on the freeway 2 weeks ago, coming.
That's how quick it can be.
Pretty challenging,
that's why
too.
It's only taken us this long.
It's not very easy to do.
Middle of the night.
Yeah.
And these are all the buildings. There's no more to be delivered.
No, we
got one more. We have a warming kitchen coming with four more classrooms.
Yeah, and you'll see a big gap down here. Oh, and then we have classrooms in the gymnasium.
That's for the first phase.
Yeah.
Well, there's still pads where there will be no buildings, and that's for a later time when the school needs to be expanded.
Exactly.
How many acres is this now, your total project?
Oh boy, I was in the 50 range.
Yeah.
Total,
the whole
property.
Everyone.
Yeah,
everyone.
That's fine. Doing the buildings.
Yeah.
And then I take it over, I do all the site work, and once the buildings go together. Mm-hmm. So here we'll do all the powering up, all the seismic bracing, just to make, you know, all the mechanical, fire sprinklers, all the electrical, that's all done on site. But I shouldn't say it's all done on site. The terminations are done on site.
Yeah.
You can see there's a lot of job walk stuff too. Any of these, you know, all of that's cosmetic. We're going to replace all that stuff. Any of the walls that are dinged up or damaged in transit will be replaced. You know, and Ty and I and Robert and I have another guy named Jim Bose, we'll all walk it, we'll beat this thing up, and then they'll come in and, you know, fix it. It's a job walk that we'll do at the very end. And it will be, it'll be impeccable. So,
come on up here if you want. We'll start here. Three. What we'll do is, this is an outdoor stage. We want to be able to, again, put together, whether it be different events from kids, we can have Battle of the Bands, we can have a variety of different events, spirit assemblies, whatever it may be, simply because of the large quad. All of this is going to be concrete, a lot of it. Obviously, with tree wells and things like that. But it's also, if you can, Ty, talk a little bit about the technology that's also in this.
One of the things we realized as we were really thinking about using the space is we had electrical, but we didn't have a lot of the other features that we wanted in outdoor stage to help make performances easier. For example, low voltage, XLR runs, microphones, data runs, HDMI runs, so we could have like a movie night, night have a screen here. So what we did is we added a conduit set of boxes, everything in one area, and routed it right where that orange PVC pipe is. There's a tree well there, so that we can have a sound and lighting table. And we can actually host full productions here, bands, there's enough power and data to do bands, film, anything, with no exposed wire. It'll all go through here, so you'll have all the students out here, no tripping, no, none of that. This is the level of detail we're taking in terms of thinking about the use and making it as seamless as possible and maximizing the facility.
Obviously, it's all full ADA access, and that's always been the challenge. We wanted to maybe go a little bit higher, but chose not to. Obviously, having wheelchair access and those kinds of things were critical, not only required, but important to us. So. And you can see, one of the things I couldn't stand is you get to a school and they have 4-foot sidewalks for 500 kids. You see the size of our sidewalks, they're huge. Okay, the ingress and egress is there simply because we don't want kids walking through the dirt and trampling through the mud to get into the classroom. We want to make it easily accessible with plenty of access, plenty of room, and pretty much no excuses. I can't imagine you can't find a spot. It's a very, what I'm going to call a Sedona, Arizona-like, very dry landscaping. We don't have any big grassy areas. In fact, we don't have any grass. We have a lot of trees, very desert-type trees, low water usage. You can see also why we did the solar tube. It's very green. We want to utilize the sun. We're also, he doesn't know this yet, so this may be a surprise. But I'm going to put together a proposal that'll have solar shades in the parking lot.
Oh, for God's sake.
Okay, and that may end up powering the entire site, plus we'll be able to sell a little bit back based on our current projection. So we'll see. Again, that isn't approved yet, but we'll get that started in the coming weeks. The one building I wanted to take you into and that you should hear and see a lot about is our culinary building. This is a building that we've been planning for many years. We have one of the, if not the best, culinary program in the state. Meaning we get millions of dollars of scholarships through this program, through different institutes, chef institutes. We have some of the best teachers, whether it be Wendy Barnes or Miss McCoo. Those two teachers that, and now Miss Barnes is obviously principal currently, but she also is heavily still involved in this project. You'll see, it's a chef's kitchen. It's not a little rinky-dink stove in the corner or a Bunsen burner. It's beautiful, and it's a facility obviously we're proud of. The program is second to none, and when high schools are cutting those kinds of things out, this high school is now adding, whether it be this program, we're also looking at a welding program, we're looking at multiple other career elements besides just, yes, we have a very rigorous A through G college curriculum. So we have kids going to Berkeley, we've had kids go to the Naval Academy, we have kids go to every institution you can think of, to include Ivy League schools. So there is no school you cannot attend by attending Vasquez High School. Let's debunk that myth right now. We have, and you'll see the list of kids at the end of our celebration. We can provide a list of kids of colleges of where they've been accepted.
I have that now for our current seniors.
Current seniors.
Purdue, Columbia, UCLA,
UC Berkeley, UC Davis, UCLA, yeah. You name it. Plus state schools all across the nation. So let's walk into the culinary.
We'll have all kinds of, I don't know that Vikings will be that level of stoves, culinary art stoves, teacher stations, all across the entire world.
We do have fundraiser
once in a while. Way better.
Well, the hope here is that this is restaurant quality. This is stuff that, you know, kids are going to actually learn, and we have some of our chefs' institutes that are going to be coming by giving demonstrations in this lab because it's so well thought out and done. And so you can see it's huge. It's a double-sized classroom, not quite double, but almost. And again, everything in it is top-notch. Everything we did, this facility will be restaurant quality. So it's very well designed.
Complete commercially, a full walk-in pantry for storage. Behind this wall, you have all of the freezers and refrigerators, a full washer, dryer, mop sink around the corner, water heater, huge water heater, bigger than our homes. So
So they're loaded. I mean, everything she would want to be able to cook for.
Multiple cooking stations, whether it be sauces. She has a sauce station and a desserts this and that. And, you know, everything as a restaurant would be. This is designed as a high-quality restaurant.
So Chef's is this an elective?
It is an elective, but it also can be utilized in some cases, depends on what the class is, as an elective for a high school graduation credit.
It's A through G, too.
But it's also, and A through G meaning it can be used as a college-level curriculum.
Okay.
Yes.
But many of these kids will select it as a career, and they're getting, and I don't mean to over-exaggerate it because it's true, millions of dollars of scholarships comes through this program. Kids are getting $50,000, $100,000 scholarship in order to go to, I can't remember, Johnson like Blue, Cordon Bleu.
Yep.
There's a couple of, and we're talking top shelf chef schools out of this facility. So obviously we decided to put a lot of money in it and invest. Kids were loving it. Kids wanted it. We have kids coming from all over the place just for this program. So you can see it's second to none. And it's rare, honestly. And high schools don't have this anymore. Very few have a program like this.
And will be ready by September.
Oh, absolutely. Yes, ma'am.
And who's your culinary?
Her name is Miss Baku, but it's also under the direction of Wendy Barnes. Yeah, so she started it, so I want to give her all the credit. But Miss Baku is just as equally competent, and she's phenomenal. A younger version of Wendy, put it that way. She's fantastic.
Any plans to offer college-level credit for...
Yes. That currently does, you can have it simultaneous.
Yes.
And you can take this as an elective A through G credit.
Uh-huh.
Which is a college-level requirement.
Yes. Yes, I understand.
So that currently exists.
Mm-hmm.
It's a bigger classroom. Some of the normal classrooms, if you will, I'll show you in our final, I probably should have started with that and worked up to this, but it is what it is. They're a little bit smaller. This is bigger because of the way that you have to utilize the curriculum. But you can see it's all in an underground. These are covered because this is going to be stained concrete. This is a stained concrete floor in this. And then... where's the hood? Is the hood going to be in this one?
Hood yes. There.
Oh, got two hoods.
The few hoods.
Emergency shower.
Everything are going to be part of this particular
emergency
facility.
Emergency
shower. We don't have those yet, do we?
Teacher's desk that matches. Yeah, this teacher demo table is actually tied to the technology as well. We designed a technology where, for example, a document camera with a full swivel arm is attached to the table so that if they're doing a demonstration, it's not just like standing up and trying to see. It's actually on camera, 6x6 on this wall right above the teacher behind them. So everybody can see everything that's going on. And it can be adjusted to any angle or even look through a microscope, for example, in biology.
If you want, we can walk through this room. It'll be there, and then we'll go into the other science lab and come out the back. You can see, and these, I don't know if they're fully open or on yet, but when they are, you don't need lighting. So we've done it in terms of teachers don't turn on the light unless it's night. So very energy efficient. Again, stained concrete, building code base around and et cetera. Same technology capacity, same in terms of the overhead projectors and things like that. Capacity in every classroom. There's a base foundational technology for every classroom. That's going to include this one.
Are we certified at all with these buildings?
Any questions on
this?
You can dim the front tube, solar tubes in each room. You can dim, so for visibility of digital presentation.
There's a wall dimmer. And it's like
right here. Oh, I'm sorry. Right there. It's not wired. That's
so you kind of close them off and then you're
you really want to see.
Yeah. If you're watching, an overhead projector. But we have them where they're HDMI, so they're all HD. So you can see it with them full on. It's that bright. You don't have to dim it. But if you want to see greater detail, you can.
Traditional
whiteboards, but then we'll also have a smart board, which will be through there.
And that you can annotate on that as well. So all the screens now are both screens and whiteboards. So you can have the image and annotate directly on a marker.
Well, Dr. Woodard, I imagine it's a great relief amid these turbulent times to have the funding for Vasquez High School in the bank.
Well, absolutely, and we're so excited to, you know, obviously and appreciative of the state and being able to kind of fund it. We were a little skeptical at first, but they did come through. We do have the money in the bank, and I can tell you, as you can see throughout the entire project, it's fully funded. It's going to be a full comprehensive high school with all the facilities necessary and the program. So yeah, we could not be more excited.
Sure. Now they say learning is a lifetime occupation, and you went and got a PhD, but I'll bet it didn't quite prepare you for putting a new school in Acton, Agua, Dulce.
That is very true. When you get that superintendent title, you never really think you're also going to be a contractor.
Yeah, exactly.
But it's been a blessing, no doubt about it. We've learned a lot, and very proud of what we've been able to accomplish with our team. So this team has done a phenomenal job, and thank the board, and more importantly, I'd like to thank the community. Mm-hmm. The community and their efforts to stand by us and back us with that initial bond, and I can't tell you how much I appreciate that.
Well, that's good, and it'll make a great difference in children's lives and families' lives in this area for, who knows, 100 years.
Well, we hope that. Obviously, this is part of the key and of this community is this school. And it's a trademark and a hallmark of this community. And we want to honor that commitment by the community with great programs and do it justice. So, yeah, as far as I'm concerned, as long as I'm in this chair, we'll have those programs and more. So appreciate, again, the community and their support and their, if you will, steadfastness of being able to stand behind us. And, you know, obviously it's been a lot of trying years, but you can see now that diligence and the vigilant effort of all the folks in the community has paid off.
Well, from the community, thank you for your perseverance.
Absolutely. I wouldn't think about doing anything else.
Well, the faint of heart would have bailed out several times before this day.
We don't have any of that.
No, and this day is a marvelous day. We look forward to cutting the ribbon and letting the kids in. Thanks
Absolutely.
Very much for the tour and everything.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Good, 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 good. Well, Principal Devoe.
Yes.
I can't believe what your anticipation is for the new Vasquez High School after taking the tour. Must be a great gratification.
It is. I'm glad you're excited too. Everybody I walk down here, the level of patience this community has shown for this project between the labor of passing bonds after trying, you know, three or four attempts to pass the bonds, and then you have the lack of state matching funds for years, having us to sort of value engineer the project into phases.
Yeah.
And then the funds coming through, the state matching funds coming through.
Yeah.
Finally looking at a full complete school. It's a lot of tears.
Yeah.
A lot of parents, teachers, students, a lot of people I walk down here. It's high emotions.
Sure,
and
sure.
And well-deserved and well-understood.
Sure, and you brought some great credentials to the table here with your technology background.
I appreciate that.
So when you were mentioning all of the hookups and all the classrooms and all the rooms, I mean, that's marvelous.
It'll be a digital school. You know, we're working on our one-to-one initiative, as we mentioned. You know, you'll have the curriculum will be on digital resources, all run through Google Classroom and Google Drive, so students will be able to have their work in a digital space that they can access from many areas. You have teachers that can access that and display it for the class in the rooms, every room equipped with all the different elements they would need to have a full digital instruction.
Sure, and I think the one-on-one device is almost a must, and I think other schools have tried it and they've had very little problems.
It's tricky. It's an emerging technology piece. It's where everyone's headed, but you know, what's the exact right path?
Yeah.
You have to be diligent and patient, and you have to do your homework, and we've been doing that. You know, between the Q conference in Palm Springs and using the right people, asking the right people and consultants to help us, talking to predecessors that have made the move already and learning from some of what their growing pains and what they learned.
Sure.
We've been patient, but we're at a point where we know we can do it. Probably within this next year we can start that initiative. We've already started a lot of the pieces, and the backbone of the network can accommodate that, so we have the capacity in the network to accommodate all of that. So we're really excited.
Sure, and that was good that AT&T had fiber here. Some places fiber's not here yet.
That's right.
But Acton, I would also, he's got it.
Yep.
So
finally.
Yeah.
Took forever.
It's like childbirth, you know.
Right.
After the baby's born, you don't think of what before. But the whole town is very supportive and want to say thank you to you.
Yeah, my pleasure.
For persevering, you know.
You know, all of us working on this, we carry with us the magnitude of patience and the labor that it's taken to get to this point. And we all realize that this school is going to be here long after we are.
Yes.
And there's an immense obligation that goes along with that to do it right.
Yeah.
And to make sure, I mean, that's why a lot of our time is spent in quality control, you know, double-checking subs, double-checking the general contractor, making sure that everything is right.
Yeah.
Because, you know, kids that I don't even know, maybe not even born yet, will be using these facilities.
100 years,
that's
sure.
That's right. And so we take it very seriously. There's pride and a lot of hard work going into it. We're doing a good job for everybody.
Well, you represent, I think, the aspirations of the people that live here. By and large, most of them could live wherever they wanted to live. They have the means, but they chose here for the rural lifestyle and quality of life, and I think you've added to the quality of life.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
You're welcome.